But you know that all the inventors usually didn't thought about money, they just thought about the value of the stuff.
Depending on what kind of inventors you're talking about. If you're talking about snowballs, yeah, you're probably right, but most of...
I know it with Edison that, tried to make money, made money, he made money with his inventions.
Paul, you are somehow an inventor. How
yeah,
do you see
Paul
the
is an inventor.
Do you want to, your ideas to be... to be copied, your hardware to be hacked?
It is hackable, right? So it's not a...
So you're a supporter of the open source?
I want some... I'm a very heavy user of open source, and also a producer of open source and software.
Do you publish your code?
Yeah.
Cool.
And, but I also, I want to make the money to afford building some other stuff.
And how can you make money without registering your patents, without copywriting your ideas?
No, it's not an, no possibility without the copyright. Or just the right to use it just myself and...
there should be no technological progress.
Yeah. But
if only Steve Jobs had an iPhone and Bill Gates a Windows.
But
a window.
There's the other side of people trying to hack it, you know?
Yeah. That's evolution.
Yeah.
But no technological progress for the masses. Just for a few. Selected few. Who have access to that technology.
Yeah. But it's always like this. If you don't have the technological means to do it, you wouldn't have to do it. Just find another means, and this is the problem.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
But I don't see any other solution of making money for
other than copywriting ideas.
Mm-hmm. But I would gladly
subscribe to that business model. For you, what is the future of copyright when everything is hackable?
I think that the option, the six-dimension cinemas and stuff like this for...
the enhancements.
Yeah, you have to pay for the...
but you will have a home.
Yeah, but the input or, I don't know, if the technology will evolve to have another enhancement available as soon as that one is.
So basically you think that the producers of content shouldn't receive anything for the content itself, but only for the added value of...
yeah, I think so.
Of experiencing
it. The content in a very...
or performing it live.
In a very high-tech environment and very appropriate environment.
It's like when you go to the poetry, you perform some song or some poetry. You know, there will always be the risk that somebody at the Chesapare is going to take your song and go to the Chesapare next week.
Yeah.
But then, you know, if you do your performance, there's only one mono, so...
yeah.
I think that's fine.
Or not.
But actually, with technology, there are probably a lot of bonos every time you don't pitch.
I know, and this is I was just thinking about it. What happens with tribute bands?
No. Didn't you have an experience just like this with Michael Jackson recently?
What?
A concert. A film concert. At the big
screen.
Arena.
Yeah, with screen, yeah. But with tribute bands, do they pay, like, part of their...
yeah, they pay. They pay for the songs. They pay royalties for performing and also for performing and for modifying the songs.
So they shouldn't pay because they're sort of advertising for the big band. Like nobody would give the YouTube tribute band for the band itself, for the fact that it reminds them of YouTube.
Yeah, and the donation things work. I mean, the only software I paid for was the open source one, which I donated a few dollars. It works. But I don't know how much in Romania.
This is about, I don't know, technology, but you're all journalists, so how would you earn your money if you don't?
No, it's easier because it's very institutionalized. You go to the office, you write it, it's printed
and you give him a copyright for 10 years. Like.
Yeah.
It's not
at point,
yeah.
It was at some
they
special
are,
project
they are dealing this
where
the,
there was the Spy and Island project.
So they get your, they have your the copyright on your
and those money
were
paid
for
the fund for
yes.
Rainforest.
They pay your salary for
it.
Yeah.
It received a
so if you would
fair amount
be
of
able
donation.
To sell your
and I'm sure
that would be better because you,
found out.
You could negotiate that would be so much better.
It's
like this, like you're a paid slave every day.
But there are a lot of bloggers who do it for free.
Ago, I think Wikipedia
some
was
of them are very good.
For their next financial
no,
year.
Yeah, uh-huh.
I was amazed how long it took and how difficult it was for them to raise 6 million
dollars. Some of them do. Like
and considering that Wikipedia has about 100, over 100 million dollars users, 100 million users every day, it took them about 6 months to raise 6 million dollars. Actually, Wikipedia was the only thing I paid for in the past 2 years. So Wikipedia and Lastfm. And I donated Wikipedia $20. But I would have expected Wikipedia to be able to raise the $6 million in a few days, and it took them 6 months. And actually, half of those $6 million they raised in the end was donations from private companies. So out of the, I don't know how many people use Wikipedia, probably
everybody.
About
yeah.
A billion, and 1 billion people donated $6 million in 6 months. So donations.
Yeah.
I would have donated if I had there.
Then we have some money for Wikipedia.
But anyway, Rado, these are two completely different questions. Like the reign of copyright is one question, and people getting paid is another question. A lot of us here, we are producing value right now, and I believe many of us have produced value all day without anyone paying us. But that's a separate question. Like, my day wouldn't be paid with copyright. It's not the way to go. But of course I want to be paid.
How do you think the content creators should be paid if not by copyright?
Well, that's a separate question, a big question. I mean, what I think is not really important because I only have an amateurish idea. But this is something for other people.
You say it's a separate question, but on the other hand, you know, when you do talk to the people who do make a difference in the system, people who take the decision makers, you do have to have the answer to this question as well, you know, because actually what I think we should be doing is, well, changing the perceptions of the decision makers, and we need to talk their language as well, you know, we need to be able to bring forward valid arguments to people who do make, do take
definitely.
These decisions. And that's why we do have to think about this as well, even though it may be amateurish. Because I took a course in... I took a course in intellectual property recently, and it was like from a more legal perspective, let's say. And, you know, I brought forward this question, you know, I went to class with my little Lawrence Lessig lesson I had learned on internet, and I told my teacher, you know, that, yeah, we should change the laws, blah, 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 blah. And my teacher said, listen, we shouldn't be changing the laws. If you really want to make it, if you want to change things, it's the artists who should be changing their minds, or the producers who should be changing their minds. They should be making the content available. Why change the laws? You know, because if the artist wants, or if the producer wants to make the content free, they can make it free. Nothing, there's no law currently that impedes them from making it free.
But this is not a good argument, because the producer will always want more money. It's like this is
the
premise, the basic premise. It's like you'll never have a producer who earns his money
of course,
on just producing and say, let's have it for free.
Of course, but how do you think the laws could be changed to make it...
The
laws
should be simply
changed
by not
following
the corporate interests. It's like enlarging the copyright time to 90 years, to 70 years from 55 to protect the copyright for Mickey Mouse. It's like...